As you know, the country grows at a rate of about 7 to 9% per annum economically, right? And there's a rule of thumb that you know, for every percentage point of GDP rise, the electricity demand should rise by about 1.5%. So it means if you're talking of 7% growth in the economy, you're talking of about 10% growth in the electricity sector. And that has been the trend in the past. Of course, there have been some dips and slowing down, but on the whole, for a longer period, the electricity demand has been growing about 10% per month. So, which means every 7 years, we have doubled the capacity of electricity generation every 10 years. So, this is a huge and challenging task. And the biggest problem is that the electricity generating systems are not cheap, at all. If you take hydropower development, the capital cost is enormous. Now, what we have been doing in the past is of twofold. Number one, we have to generate our own cash, which we call in our own parlance, internal cash generation. Now, no bank will give you 100% of the capital cost. If you want to be down, it will not give you 100%. So, once again, the rule of thumb had been in the past, they would like us to finance about 15 to 30% using our own internal cash. Now that norm is still valid. So, if you want to invest in power generation projects, you also must have your own capital to invest. So, anyway, I was just talking about new investments. So, first of all, we are finding these investments in the power sector, and more often than not, and very obviously for in many cases, we have to look at the international lending agencies. Early on, the World Bank, or they don't fund us anymore on the power generation sector. ADB, they used to fund us on the infrastructure, not so much on the generation per se. And then we have the bilateral sources like the Japanese government, Indian government, Chinese government, so on and so forth. And also then we have the private sector investments. So first we have to find the private sector investments. And so once you find the investment, then you look for the technology. Now, what we do in the Ceylon Electricity Board is that it's a captive market that we have. Now, if you want to go and buy a share, you go and buy a share from the cheaper source or the source that you like most, you buy your share, you know. In the energy sector, it's not the case. You are hardwired and we are monopoly. So, whatever we dish out, we have to take. Therefore, the Ceylon Electricity Board has a national duty to generate power at the what we call the least cost. So every year we do a rolling plan for the next 20 years, because you also must realize that once you make an investment decision, it's not like investing on a small factory or something. You know, maybe after 5 years, if you don't like the factory, you can shift the production to something else. But here, once you fix your technology and the investment, that is there for life virtually, like at least 20, 30 years, if not for 50 years. But Luxembourg has been there for more than 50 years. So the decision that you take today is going to be there for the next 50 to 60 years with us. Then we have to make the right kind of decision today for a very long future. So we have to look at the very long future generation expansion. Therefore, what we do an exercise for the least cost generation expansion planning studies. We take a window of about 20 years and forecast the demand growth and try to match the least possible cost options to meet that demand. There are various techniques for doing that. I'm going to go in detail, right? So, in this scenario, first we have to also find out, as you said, what are the domestic resources that we have. Unfortunately, contrary to most of our beliefs, we don't have anything to talk about except the hydros in the past. Thanks to our hydropower father, late engineer D.J. we have used and harnessed hydros to the maximum. We are still doing it as much as possible. And as you very correctly said, the upper company has been one of the largest, last hydro resources. But still, there are a couple of others to go. We are still doing the Umayo project, 120 megawatts. And Broadless was just signed up, and so there are some projects. But hydro is limited, and we know that for sure. What is the other domestic resource we have? As you said, we have solar, we have wind, we have biomass, right? But some of these chemicals are still in the embryonic stage, or still not mature enough for us to harvest in the best possible way to commercial scale. Of course, solar, PV have been there for more than half a century, right? Wind has been there and has been developing over the last 20 years very rapidly. And biomass, there's a lot of research going on, and we can harness to a certain extent. Then there are things like wave and tidal and that kind of thing. We are talking of very, very small margins, so I'm not going to be addressing those kind of resources. So those are the domestic resources that we have, we can harness in the future. And we are harnessing some of them, and we are encouraging some of them to come in a big way. Then you have to obviously look at the base load requirement, not depending on the vagaries of weather, not depending on the changes in the climate patterns. Now, for instance, you take, I will give a simple example. Let's say that you have 100 megawatts of solar. You have few cloudy days, and for those days, you have another 100 megawatts somewhere installed just to meet certain maturity. Take wind for instance. You have 100 megawatts of wind, and there are enough days where you don't have wind at all. They have another 100 megawatts standing somewhere just to generate and give the power when the wind is not there. So these things like solar, wind and so on and so forth, though they are renewable, though they are domestic, they are indigenous, right? They have their own limitations and problems. Therefore, we have to go for what we call the base load power plants. The base means, I mean, not to be the base in the technical sense that we are talking about, that we in our own products we call dispatchable energy. That is, on the call and behest of our own system controller, they can, hey, come on, you generate power now. Then they are there. You can call the sun to say, thou shine. You can call the wind to say, thou blow. Right? So we have to have this kind of plants that are using, unfortunately, fossil fuels. Right? So, for the last few decades, we have been depending on oil, which is a wrong option by itself in my own thinking, but we didn't have anything else to do but that to burn oil, because all our efforts since early 80s to put these coal power plants have failed miserably due to, I would say, absolute lack of information about the coal. Right? If we had done that, all the problems related to this present day tariff problem would have been not there at all. We failed to capitalize on the cheap coal that are available at that time. That's history. You can't trace back and you can't buy the history at any cost, anyway. So, fortunately, we have now taken a decision to go for coal, and the first power plant is in operation for the last 2 years. And contrary to the belief, popular belief, that it's a troublesome plant, I would say we have paid back the entire capital cost with the short span of 2 years. It was an enormous investment of $450 million. Just do your calculation and see how much of money is there. Okay, let me tell you how we did that. To generate a unit of electricity from coal, it requires only about 7 rupees and 80 cents. Right, for 7 rupees, you can generate a unit of coal, a unit of electricity from coal. I'm only talking about the fuel cost. To do the same thing using diesel or heavy fuel or whatever, it cost you minimum 20, 21 or even 30 rupees a unit. Take the difference and the amount of energy that has generated. Right? It has already paid back by itself. So, we are now into the second and the third stage. So, this the third, second plant is coming to operation October 2013 and the third plant in May 2014. With that, I am sure the power sector will now start stabilizing. Now, what is the scenario for the future? Right? I'm sure you now realize that, you know, there are no other option to go but coal way. But coal has its own problems, as you said. We are susceptible to fluctuations in prices, and also the other pressure on us, by the global community, to generate less and less carbon dioxide, and there's pressure to go slow on coal. But look at other countries. I mean, they have been generating coal for decades and decades and decades using coal. So why not Sri Lanka? Right? then we have no other option but to go for coal right now. That's the most realistic way. But we have not shut the door for other fossil fuels as well. What are the fossil fuels that we have? Now we have used oil, we have mineral resources, we have used coal. The other option is to go for gas. Now gas is an extremely clean energy, but gas comes at cost. Probably because the gas is costly, the gas utilization infrastructure is extremely costly. The gas comes to us in the form of liquid. And to make gas liquefy, you have to pressurize to about 600 times. Right? And the gas comes at minus 172 degrees Celsius. So they are coming in special containers and they have to be transferred in special containers, and you need to bring it to the shore. You have, just imagine a fluid flowing at minus 172 degrees C. What amount of insulation required, and once it comes on shore, you are stored in those kind of containers. They use gas sparingly somehow to generate that. If you do that, you get absolutely clean energy. Right? So we have not shut our doors for gas. We are looking at gas very seriously. Coal has come to stay, and oil we are not encountering anymore because of the high price fluctuations, and that is a scenario for the next several decades. Now, then look at once again on the renewable side that you want me to speak about. Solar, yes, we are going cautiously because solar costs are still high, but it's still expected to come down in price. Because if you ask me just now, what is the unit of energy using solar, it will be in the range of 20 rupees to 40 rupees, a unit of electricity. Even in oil, you can generate much, much less, right? But we have enormous potential to use solar. That's the plus point. The second thing is wind has come in a very big way. Already you may not know that we have about 75 megawatts of wind in our system. Now wind has certain other problems, right? Now wind is a better choice than solar in terms of cost. The problem is, as I said, the wind varies all the time. Now just imagine a wind power plant connected next to your house. What will influence your voltage more? The power plant is in Kanadisa or Laxapada or the wind plant? Wind plant will start changing your system parameters all the time. So when the wind slows down, your voltage starts going up, but of course it will pick up. So you get fluctuations in your home. Right? So therefore there are certain safeguards. There are certain amount of injection of wind to a system. As once again, as a rule of thumb, these are all can be calculated and shown what is right or the right level. We don't allow wind to come, this kind of fluctuating source to come in, sometimes 10 or 50, more than 15% for sure. That means you must have a very stable power plant of 100 megawatts to accommodate 15 megawatts of wind. You see, you got my point. Or even 10 megawatts of wind to be on the better side. So therefore, there are limitations as to the level of injection where you can give wind, you see, because of this very fluctuating nature. So these are the technical limitations that you have in utilizing renewables and also economic reasons. That's the cost. So those are my few thoughts about the future scenario for electricity in the country.